1968, Memphis, Tennessee. A local labor dispute escalates into a major battle for economic and civil rights. It draws Martin Luther King Jr. into the final confrontation of his life and marks the end of an era in the civil rights movement. Years after the freeing of the slaves, their descendants were still relegated to the lowest rungs of the economic ladder. The Mississippi Delta in the 1960s was the poorest region of the United States, with most of its black population living in abject poverty. Migration to the city did little to change this. In Memphis, most attempts by black workers to organize for decent wages and working conditions were brutally suppressed. With the underpaid black workers still forming the basis of the region's economy, the values of the Old South remained essentially unchanged.
One more river to cross.
During the 1960s, Memphis spared itself the uprisings which drew national attention to Little Rock, Birmingham, and Selma by integrating facilities in a relatively peaceful manner. Blacks were finally admitted to movies, libraries, and lunch counters, but economically, they continued to occupy the most menial jobs for the lowest of wages. Nowhere was this more evident than in the Department of Public Works.
This was a job a white man could not have. It was beneath the level of a white man. This is a social caste. This is a job reserved for blacks. It was not a clean job. They had to wear filthy clothes. They had to work in filth. They had to drag garbage cans, I mean, tubs of garbage.
Most of those tubs had holes in them, garbage leaking all over you. When you got home in the evening, you had to stop at the door to pull off your shoes and pull off those little dirty clothes because maggots had fell all on you.
The men worked long hours with no overtime pay. There were no grievance procedures, no paid vacations, no sick leave. If a man got injured on the job, he could be fired. Wages were so low that a full-time worker could still qualify for welfare.
The Lhasa residents, they felt that we were satisfied because most of those people would give you a little handout. So we just gotten tired of those handouts. You almost could tell a worker when you saw him in the street. He had a head on too large, his shoes was too big, his coat was too long. From handouts, you know, we worked every day, and let us have the money that we can be able to buy and pick as other people do.
In 1963, T.O. Jones led 32 fellow workers off the job. The city responded by firing them all. Most were eventually rehired, but the point had been made. Union activity would not be tolerated. Jones refused to go back and continued his efforts to organize the men.
You know, he used to tell me, because I used to see all this paperwork and stuff, he would tell me, he said, these people don't realize that they don't have to live like this. They don't realize that if they come together, that they can overcome these little things, you know, although they think they can't win, but they can. You know, it was like he was telling me, convincing me that he was right.
Jones succeeded in getting affiliation with AFSCME, the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees. But few men were willing to risk their jobs by joining. Despite this, Jones persisted.
In the first part of 68, you know, you had more and more people, they started meeting, you know, what they would call like wildcat-like meetings. But it was more people coming every time, and they let him know that it was close at hand.
February 1968, after years of unheeded complaints about faulty equipment, the inevitable happens. On a rainy day, an electrical short activates one truck's garbage compressor. Two men are crushed to death. There is no workman's compensation, no insurance for their families. Feeling they have nothing left to lose, 1,300 sanitation workers walk off the job.
We tried to get to the union officials. Mr. T.O. Jones, who seems to be the spokesman for the union and a former sanitation employee worker, he said he had no comment at this time.
Jones leads the men to the office of his friend, Bill Ross, head of the Memphis Labor Council. Ross calls Washington and informs union official P.J. Ciampa of the strike.
He says, Bill, you go out there and you tell those people to go back to work. And I'll come down there and see what I can do. I said, buddy, I'm the only white man in this building with 1,300 black souls out there. I'm not about to go out there and tell those people to go back to work. Now, if you want to tell them to go back to work, you come down here and do it yourself.
Labor was not used to having 1,300 black men out on strike, on a strike that labor did not call. And on a strike that, where there was no contract, there was no recognition of the union, you know, you were in a kind of nebulous position. Nobody knew who was what, when, or where.
Standing firmly against the union is newly elected mayor Henry Loeb.
It has been held that all employees of a municipality may not strike for any purpose. This, of course, includes employees of the Public Works Department.
Henry typifies, and I, you know, I guess many blacks would say that I do too, what I call the plantation psychology. That is, that the blacks are the white man's responsibility, that we have to look out for them, that we own the plantation, they work on the plantation, we've got to look out for them.
P.J. Ciampa arrives in Memphis to talk to the mayor about getting the men back to work. But Loeb refuses to recognize either him or the union as a legitimate bargaining agent for the workers.
I was advised that you were out of work in violation of the law. I don't know of any law in Tennessee that says you have to subject yourself to indentured servitude. And I don't think that I'm breaking the law one iota, because I think as a free American citizen, I'm going to express myself. As a free American citizen, you are expressing yourself by saying I am not working for those stinking wages and conditions.
Now, it's certainly right that you should come to your mayor and bring up anything you want. You can ask me any question, just as you used to ask me. And this is what I suggested.
It wasn't nothing but a joke, just a big joke. He was talking about, you know, his open door, you could come talk to him. There's no way you could have got close to his office, not a worker, you know. And everything he was saying was just a big joke, and that's why people was laughing.
Public employees cannot strike against their employer, and this you can't do. I suggested to these men today that you go back to work.
Henry Loeb knew that he was going to convince those men to go back to work. He knew that they trusted him. He knew they believed in him. He knew they'd do what he said. And I don't know this, but I'll bet he was the most surprised man in the world when they said, no, 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 we're not going back to work. No way. Going to have a union.
As long as you continue to break the law and endanger the public health and welfare, there will be no further talk at any level of government.
Do you agree with the stand the mayor is taking in the sanitation dispute?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Mainly because the fact that the men are breaking the law.
No, I do not.
What do you think he should do?
He should go and give the people a raise, because they are here just like everybody else.
I do, definitely.
Why?
Well, I've just about come to the conclusion the more you pet somebody, the more you're going to have to pet them.
The community is very worked up about this, and I can't really predict what might happen, but there is very high feeling in the community.
When a public official orders a group of men to get back to work and then we'll talk, and treats them as though they are not men, that's a racist point of view. And no matter how you dress it up in terms of whether or not a union can organize, it's still racism. For at the heart of racism is the idea that a man is not a man, that a person is not a person.
When the men refuse to return, Loeb hires replacement workers. While the strikers picket the depot, the trucks, heavily guarded by Memphis police, begin their rounds. With the mayor refusing to talk to union representatives, AFSCME President Jerry Wirth arrives in Memphis. He knows that a loss here would be a major blow to his plans to organize municipal workers throughout the South. But he's not ready to back a major confrontation between a powerful mayor and workers who have not been prepared for the hardships of a drawn-out strike. Hoping for enough of a concession to get the men back to work, he takes their case to the newly formed city council, which includes three black members.
I want you to resolve that, subject to the inhibitions in law, that these men may collectively deal with you through a chosen representative.
When the council refuses to get involved, Wirth is outraged. Their intransigence pushes him farther than he had intended to go.
This strike can only go on so long as these men, these residents and workers for the city of Memphis, want it to go on. But I assure you of one thing on behalf of the 375,000 members of our international union, that so long as they want help and they want support, by God, they're going to get that help and that support.
Nearly 700 Memphis sanitation workers staged a four-hour sit-in demonstration at City Hall today on this 11th day of the city's garbage strike. The workers vowed they would not leave until a city council committee produced a resolution recommending union recognition and a dues checkoff.
We decided to sit in, which was not, but there was no damage or anything like that. We were just not going to leave and force the city to do something, either arrest all of us or address these issues. So we sent out to get food for 700-800 people.
While sandwiches are made, the council's Public Works Committee meets behind closed doors. By evening, they return with a resolution to recognize the union and promise to present it to the full council the next day.
So the meeting ended that day on a very high note, that the Public Works Committee would make this recommendation to the council, the council would adopt it, and that would be that.
But the morning papers express outrage at this perceived attack on the orderly life of the city. Strike supporters arrive at the auditorium to hear the vote. At the same time, the full council meets in private session and decides not to allow the previous day's resolution to be introduced. When the council finally appears, they vote to support the mayor and immediately adjourn.
There was great anger, outrage, not only that they went back on their word to sizable numbers of us and to many people from the black community, clergy and the like, but then that they abruptly adjourned their meeting and would not even at least have some kind of a hearing to talk about what had happened and why they changed their position.
Hoping to cool off the crowd's anger, union leaders get permission from the police to lead a march to a nearby church.
Everybody will fall in line, and we will get on the west side of the street and march down in an orderly fashion to Mason Hall.
When the marchers get a few blocks down the street, police cars appear and begin pushing against them. The crowd protests, but the police continue. Finally, the men push back.
Police used riot control gas and nightsticks this afternoon to break up a disturbance among a group of striking garbage men. Part of a group of about 1,000 marchers began rocking a police car, and police waded in.
They just came in and started throwing at mace on the people, and I didn't think it was right. And they recognized who I was. And they just got right in my face and started blowing all in my face. Some of the guys picked me up and carried me on down down Gayosa, getting away from them.
The events of today demonstrate that Memphis will not tolerate civil disorder, and with the continuing help and support of all the people of this city, to whom I am most grateful for their many expressions of confidence, order will be maintained.
Across town, outraged strikers and community leaders gather at union headquarters.
I feel like the wheel been assaulted by the police department.
Those people yesterday, when they told me there'd be an honest council meeting today, and you and I would have a chance to talk to this council, I regret I believed them. They lied to me and they lied to you.
I am sick and tired of Negroes getting on their knees and begging the Red White Father for the crumbs that fall from his table.
As racial tensions mount in the wake of the macing, the black community organizes itself under the leadership of James Lawson, a major strategist of nonviolence in the civil rights movement.
The way in which these men have been treated thus far has galvanized Negroes and people of goodwill to their support. We are declaring a slogan, no new clothes for Easter, keep your money in your pockets. In other words, we are insisting that we will discriminate in our right not to buy.
We need some folk to march. We need some folk to answer the phone and do clerical work. We need some people who can serve as pickets downtown. On the bottom of this page, you will see a place for you to sign your name, what day of the week and what hours you can work.
We pass the offering plates, we use buckets, and we have the standing room only people. You know, people standing in the aisles and then every seat full in between. And these buckets went like clockwork, right straight across the thing. We didn't need any ushers whatsoever. The people did it themselves, you know. It was just really a beautiful expression of common purpose and unity.
Community backed us up 100%. And we sprouts as it did. We couldn't have made it if it had not been for the community. We couldn't have made it.
We will not stop until every black man get a chance to lift himself up and begin to rise. We are on the march, and we will stay there, and nothing will stop us.
The Memphis strike becomes a movement. One day, a new sign appears on the picket line.
And that sign just said so much. I mean, it was, the impact of it went around the world. And it didn't say, I want freedom. It didn't say, I want justice. It didn't say, I want a raise. It didn't say more, better health care. All it said was, I am a man.
As the community joins in daily marches and nightly rallies, the movement continues to press its demands on city council.
If I insult you by telling the truth,
I move we adjourn.
If I insult you
second.
By speaking and saying that these men have fought for this country, these men have died for this country, and all they're asking for is a little bit of self-respect.
It's been moved.
If I say, if I insult you, brothers, then I will go to heaven insulting you with the last ounce.
All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
No opposed?
No.
I'm very sorry. We would like to respect.
There was very little conciliatory talk. There wasn't nobody, you couldn't have negotiated with any of them if you any more than you could negotiate with the devil.
In response to the consul's inaction, the movement escalates its tactics. By refusing to leave the consul chambers, they force the city to arrest hundreds of strike supporters.
Been in ourselves, in our people, and in our unity, in the courage that we have to say no to racism and injustice. And so this is about our unity, our togetherness, our standing, our being willing to face macing, marching, and anything else in order that out of that unity we will have a victory.
Meanwhile, the white community rallies around the mayor.
Everywhere that Henry Loeb went, they'd give him a standing ovation. He didn't go to the black community. Man, I can remember going to the Rotary Club and all those places, you know, and just everybody just clapping and carrying on, you know. Stick in there, Henry, you know. So it's mighty hard to back down when you're getting that kind of apparent support.
Memphis has been known for a better way of doing business.
Almost everybody stood rock solid that we white people knew what was best for those black people. And on that rock we stood for a couple of weeks. Not much longer, though. Not much longer.
If you can't get a decent salary for men who are working in the name of God, how the hell are you going to get rid of poverty?
The movement begins to attract the attention of national civil rights leaders.
Now, one other point that's happening here. There's been so much tension between some of the trade unions and some of the civil rights groups that all over the country people are telling me, you can't depend on the unions, they're anti-Negro, they won't stand with you. Well, I think the record here shows that in Memphis, this fight is going to be won because the black people of this community and the trade unions stand together, man to man.
To maintain the momentum of the movement, James Lawson invites his old friend Martin Luther King to Memphis. As head of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, King has long seen the struggles for economic and civil rights as inseparable.
That is why Negroes support labor's demands and fight laws which curb labor. That is why the labor hater and labor baiter is virtually always a twin-headed creature, spewing anti-Negro epithets from one mouth and anti-labor propaganda from the other mouth.
To dramatize the connection between economic and civil rights, King has planned the Poor People's Campaign, a massive demonstration to be held in Washington that spring.
This will be no mere one-day march in Washington, but a trek to the nation's capital by suffering and outraged citizens who will go to stay until some definite and positive action is taken to provide jobs and income for the poor.
The Poor People's Campaign was being discussed before the strike broke out in Memphis. It just so happened that, and that's why we've always maintained that God was in the plan, that the Memphis strike, the garbage workers, the sanitation workers, provided a near ideal scenario to talk about eliminating poverty.
Some members of King's staff feel that he should devote his full attention to the new campaign and that Memphis will be a costly detour on the road to Washington. After listening to arguments on both sides, King makes his decision.
Just like Jesus would be coming into my life. I was full of joy, and full of determination. Wherever Dr. King was, I want to be there.
All labor has dignity. But you are doing another thing. You are reminding not only Memphis, but you are reminding the nation that it is a crime for people to live in this rich nation and receive starvation wages. We built gigantic buildings to kiss the sky. We built gargantuan bridges to span the seas through our spaceships. We were able to carve highways through the stratosphere. Through our airplanes, we were able to dwarf distance and place time in chains. Through our submarines, we were able to penetrate oceanic depths. It seems that I can hear the God of the universe saying, even though you've done all of that, I was hungry and you fed me not.
It was just tremendous. He was quite thrilled and mentioned it. It was like an old-fashioned movement of the early days, because it had been a long time since you had gathered that many people together, at least 6,000, and they were all in harmony, and somebody wasn't shouting, Black Power or something else. People were in harmony, and he noticed that and was impressed by that. And felt really good about it. I mean, it almost like vindicated him that the nonviolent era was not over.
The atmosphere also moves him to increase his involvement in the strikers' cause.
I tell you what you ought to do, and you're together here enough to do it. In a few days, you ought to get together and just have a general work stoppage in the city of Memphis.
King promises to return in 10 days to lead a mass demonstration in support of the workers.
Now the entire Negro community is behind this struggle, and we're concerned not only for what happens to these sanitation workers, but we're also serving notice on the city of Memphis that the time for moving systematically, creatively, but hastily towards genuine change is at hand.
I tried over and over again to help Henry to realize what was happening, because I would spend time with the sanitation workers in the basement of old Second Presbyterian Church downtown. And I saw them, it was like a war zone. People were bringing in supplies. I mean, sacks of flour and sugar and groceries, just survival kind of experience. And I kept saying to Henry that this thing is going to blow up. This city will blow up.
As the date for the march approaches, anti-King sentiment builds in the white community.
It was thick against him. It was cold, and the threats were openly, that so-and-so, we don't need him here. And whites would come to the council and say that openly, and the councilman would agree with him. And you had to sit there and listen to all of those threats and knowing exactly how they felt about him.
Voices are also raised against King by young militant groups like the Invaders, who are seeking a greater role in the movement.
If you said Black Power, you were an immediate threat, and we were saying it, which incidentally was not necessarily welcomed by the elements of the Black Power structure that existed at that time. They were very suspicious. They did not want young militants telling people how to organize.
If what you are out there pushing is a violent concept, a concept that is so closely, that was at that time, so closely aligned to what the perceived concept of the Muslims and other groups were in guerrilla warfare. You know, how can you be brought to be a part of the strategy team of a nonviolent movement
Most of us who were considered to be militants were trained in the nonviolent movement. So it's not a question of our not believing in nonviolence. It was that we saw nonviolence as a tactic and a tactic alone.
Unaware of the increasingly volatile climate in Memphis, King returns to lead the march.
Several thousand Negro demonstrators are participating in this largest civil rights demonstration ever in Memphis, Tennessee. Many of the demonstrators are carrying the sign, "I am a man." They stretch out for several blocks. Police are on hand with about 600 officers. Almost the entire force is standing by here in case any trouble might break out.
A mile away at Hamilton High School, the first sign of trouble appears. When students throw stones at passing vehicles, police descend on the school. One young woman is seriously injured, and by the time the students join the march downtown, the story of injury becomes a rumor of death at the hands of the police. When King's arrival is delayed, militant voices can be heard in the increasingly restless crowd. Exhausted from his work on the Poor People's Campaign, King finally arrives from the airport, and the march begins.
When you looked at Martin, you saw the tiredness in him. It was not a tiredness that a vacation relieves. It was a deep tiredness, like a tiredness of the soul.
Ahead of us, Beale Street was filled to the sidewalks with people. I didn't quite like that. And we couldn't correct it. And when I got up about two blocks up the street on Beale, I heard what sounded like windows breaking behind us.
Next thing we heard was sirens, and policemen were coming from every direction with tear gas, and they started surging down on the lines. I remember one officer came right up to my face and began to curse. Someone who was near me was trying to tell him that this man is a city councilman. He's a city official. And he said these words, "I don't give a damn who he is. I mean, get your so-and-so out of here now, or you're going to get the butt of this gun or a bullet out of it."
Then I ran back and said, "Martin, I need for you to leave the march." And he protested. And I said, "You see the police up there, they're after us." And I refused to accept Martin's protest, and I said, "Take Martin King down that way and get him out of the area."
For the first time, King has lost control of a mass demonstration and is forced to retreat.
Chaos has just broken out downtown. That sound you just heard was the sound of a tear gas fired by a police officer in an attempt to thwart this unruly demonstration. We repeat, several Negro youths started running down Main Street, smashing windows as they ran. Police have formed a cordon across Main Street at this time in an attempt to at least calm the demonstration, which has gotten completely out of hand.
When the march degenerated into a riot, abandoned by its leaders, the police, with my full sanction, took the necessary action to restore law and order and to protect the lives and property of the citizens of Memphis.
Determined that Memphis will not explode like Newark and Detroit, Loeb calls in the National Guard. Before night falls, the entire city is under martial law.
Out in the master lane,
is hereby ordered and invoked a curfew which requires all citizens to be off the streets of the city of Memphis by 7 p.m. tonight and remain off the streets until 5 a.m. Persons on the streets during these hours who do not have legitimate business or emergency reasons will be subject to arrest. What needs to be done will be done.
The city of Memphis has willfully, and I mean willfully and vagrantly, attacked the black community. It's a clear line here.
But you have attacked Dr. King, though, by taking over what was to be a nonviolent march and making it violent.
I don't know why you persist in saying Dr. King. This is Memphis. This city belongs to people here. This city belongs to people here. The black people here have to set the temper of the times. If Dr. King is going to come in here, he's going to have to come in here and analyze the situation and meet the needs of black people here.
And if he doesn't?
If he doesn't, the same thing will happen to him everywhere he goes that happened here in Memphis.
What happened yesterday in Memphis was totally uncalled for. Just as Martin Luther King's proposed march on Washington is uncalled for and unnecessary. And I hope that well-meaning Negro leaders and individuals in the Negro community in Washington will now take a new look at this man who gets other people into trouble and then takes off like a scared rabbit.
And now it becomes a larger issue than just 1,300 sanitation workers. Now the focus, and I think that's one of the things Doc did not want to happen. The focus is now moved from 1,300 sanitation workers and their right to work and to earn a decent living and to have benefits to an issue of, is Martin King still a creditable leader?
Dr. King,
yeah.
You've been criticized for coming in from outside and then abandoning the march when the going got rough. What's your reaction to that?
My only reaction is that I did not abandon the march when the going got rough. I have always said that I will not lead a violent demonstration.
He felt very down. I think he was really wrestling with, is my cavalry looming before me? Am I really losing it? Has there been a change in the mindset of the people of this country? And did I miss it?
It really got him, sort of caught up in saying that I'm not going to allow violence to take over the civil rights movement of nonviolence. So he came back to Atlanta and summons all of us. I was in Philadelphia working on the Poor People's Campaign, and he summons us in Atlanta and said that we saw on the news what had happened, but he said that he wanted us to go back to Memphis, and he was going to march. He was going to have a nonviolent march in Memphis, Tennessee.
Now, events and nature have put it so that, in fact, that he's got to come back to Memphis, and he's got to organize to lead a peaceful, nonviolent march in Memphis, because if you can't do it here, you get stopped coming out of Marks, Mississippi. You get stopped in Birmingham. You get stopped in Georgia. You get stopped coming from California. Wherever a leg of the Poor People's Campaign is coming from, it's stopped now.
While the nation is losing faith in King's leadership, the strikers continue to be true to the nonviolent philosophy of King and Lawson.
I'm gonna live a life I sing about in my soul. I'm gonna stand right, always shun the wrong. If I'm in a crowd, if I'm alone, all the streets are in my home. I'm gonna live life I sing about in my song.
Nothing would be more tragic than to stop at this point
in Memphis. We've got to see it through. Be concerned about your brother. You may not be on strap, but either we go up together or we go down together. The question is not, if I stop to help this man in need, what will happen to me? The question is, if I do not stop to help the sanitation workers, what will happen to them? That's the question.
As national involvement in the march escalates, King's staff arrive in Memphis to ensure that this demonstration will not end in violence.
And there was some dissension among some of the staff who didn't want to come back, who thought it was a setup, who thought it was a trick, you know, and who thought that the whole situation was set up to really discredit him and to discredit SCLC, because a lot of the stuff that the FBI was doing and other law enforcement agencies trying to discredit the organization, they saw this as another ploy to do some more discrediting. But Dr. King was determined that he was going to come back to Memphis and have a nonviolent march.
If it became accepted that you can no longer have massive demonstration, that would have taken the heart and soul out of the movement. We simply couldn't let that happen.
Through workshops and meetings, the staff make sure that this time the more militant factions of the community are not excluded from the planning of the march.
We felt like we could mobilize 10, 20,000 people. And that's what we were telling Dr. King. We can bring the people out. If you will let your folk know that you support our effort to do so, and if you can get them off us a little bit, we'll go ahead and show you what kind of strength we have. But we have to be full partners. We cannot be second-rate citizens in this thing. So he agreed. He was ready to do that.
The city awaits the arrival of Dr. Martin Luther King today. He plans to defy a federal court order which bans his second mass march in Memphis next Monday. It would now appear that if the court order is not amended or dissolved, King, as he did in Montgomery and Birmingham, faces another direct confrontation with authorities, this time in the streets of Memphis.
Gloomy day anyway, cloudy, began the rain in one of our Memphis rains that was a persistent downpour.
But the magnetism that was in that temple that night is really indescribable, especially given the lightning and the fact that people came out regardless of the weather. And it was just something to behold, it really was.
Now we're going to march again, and we've got to march again in order to put the issue where it is supposed to be. And force everybody to see that there are 1,300 of God's children here suffering. Now about injunctions. We have an injunction, and we're going into court tomorrow morning to fight this illegal, unconstitutional injunction. All we say to America is be true to what you said on paper. If I lived in China or even Russia or any totalitarian country, maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I could understand the denial of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they haven't committed themselves to that over there. But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right. And so just as I say we aren't going to let any dogs or water hoses turn us around, we aren't going to let any injunction turn us around.
This was a rare moment with the rain on the outside, the feeling of intense humanity on the inside, the feeling that, you know, we're engaged in something momentous together.
We've got some difficult days ahead, but it really doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
I think Doc really thought at first that the great possibility was that his death was going to take place somewhere along the road on the way to Washington with the Poor People's Campaign. But I think after the violence in Memphis, the focus was changed and Doc really knew. I really believe he knew that Memphis was the place.
I went to 306, and I said, it's 5 o'clock, guys, we gotta go. He said, oh no, we call the house, and your wife said dinner's at 6. And so we stood together. He was here, and I was here. On that balcony, I said, okay, we are going, let's go. And I walked. He was leaning over the rail, talking to Jesse. And Ben Branch was a musician who had the Breadbasket Band.
And Dr. King said to him, I want you to play Precious Lord. And I want you to play it real pretty for me. And that was it.
Martin Luther King Jr. was killed tonight in Memphis, Tennessee, shot in the face as he stood alone on the balcony of his hotel room. He died in a hospital an hour later.
I ask every citizen to reject the blind violence that has struck Dr. King, who lived by nonviolence.
Memphis are deeply saddened by the tragic event that has just occurred in our city. and we extend our deepest sympathies to Dr. King's family. We call upon all citizens of our community, as Dr. King would have wished, to maintain peace and order.
In his office, he asked me to have a word of prayer. But the fact that the mayor, whom I was holding accountable for his death, asked me to pray in his office, that to me was one of the greatest insults of all my life.
Memphis clergy march to City Hall and confront the mayor.
We who are white confess our implication in this tragic event by our failure to speak and act clearly and specifically with conviction and courage to the attitudes of prejudice and patterns of injustice which produce a society in which this act could occur. We ask all who share this feeling to join us in this confession.
Mr. Mayor, this is the third time I've come to you pleading. If we had been able to get a hearing as ministers of the black community, we never would have needed to send for King or anybody else. But you would not hear. You will not hear now.
April 8th, people from across the country join the Memphis black community to keep King's promise to stage a nonviolent march in support of the striking workers.
We had announced that this was to be a solemn, quiet march that day. And believe it or not, it was hard to hear people talking. All you could really hear were the sounds of leather against pavement, people walking.
I want to say to the sanitation workers who are manning this picket lines in this struggle, you are not alone. We are with you. And I say to Mayor Loeb, even though it may be painful, before this fight of the sanitation workers is over, we're going to drag you into the 20th century somehow.
Under pressure from all sides, Henry Loeb allows negotiations to resume and for any settlement to be sent directly to the city council for approval. Loeb himself will never budge from the stance he has held since the first day of the strike.
Those in favor of the motion will signify by saying aye as your name is called, no if opposed.
Aye.
Aye.
As of this morning, as of less than a half hour ago, as a matter of fact, your committee reached an agreement with the city.
Union officials spell out the terms of the agreement. They include salary increase, benefits, grievance procedure, fair treatment, and most importantly, official recognition of the union by the city of Memphis.
All in favor of the recommendation, let it be known by saying aye. Those who oppose, will you stand? We lost many things, but we stayed and we got the victory.
When the strike was settled, he cried. He had a telegram in his hand, and I remember he showed it to me, and it was from Hubert H. Humphrey, the vice president of the United States at that time, and Hubert H. Humphrey told him that he was congratulating him on, you know, winning the strike, and he admired him for that, you know. And my father was sitting there in the chair, he was just holding it, looking at it, and he was just crying. And it was beautiful.
Against all odds, and without consulting the International Union, these men had defied the laws of Tennessee and challenged the power structure of the Old South. 63 days after walking out, they returned to work heroes in the struggle of people everywhere for civil rights and decent working conditions. Their victory gave Jerry Wirth's union the momentum to organize municipal workers throughout the South. 2 weeks after the end of the strike, Martin Luther King's Poor People's Campaign began its march to Washington from the Lorraine Motel. But it was a Memphis strike that marked a turning point in the civil rights movement by demanding that the nation see and hear its working poor.
I'm a man. I guess it did mean something, didn't it?